Please stand as you are able for confession and forgiveness. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, mighty and immortal, you know that as fragile creatures surrounded by great dangers, we cannot by ourselves stand upright. Give us strength of mind and body, so that even when we suffer because of human sin, we may rise victorious through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 58. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins will be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord, and I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Hebrews chapter 12. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom, and the tempest, and the sound of trumpet, and the voice whose words made the hearers beg that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, "I tremble with fear." Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, "I tremble with fear." But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God and heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking, for if they did not escape when they refused the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time his voice shook the earth, and now he has promised, "Yet once more I shall shake not only the earth, but also the heaven." This phrase, "yet once more," indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For indeed, our God is a consuming fire. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hello, so good to see you all this morning.
About this time of year, most families are busily getting prepared for school, back to school, right? And our Sunday school team's been working diligently all summer. We're really excited to welcome you all back for Sunday school coming up in September. So what are some of the things that you do to prepare to go back to school? Some shopping? What do you go shopping for? School supplies. Mm-hmm. One of the things I always used to make my kids do, not that this was their favorite thing, but we would pull out all of their old clothes, all their old fall and winter clothes from the previous year, and I would make them try it on to see what fit and what didn't fit so I'd figure out what we needed to get. Does your mom do that too? A little bit, right? All right. Why is that? Why do we need to do that? Is it because you keep growing? Yeah, because that's what young people do. They keep growing year over year. That's what you're supposed to do. All right, so here's another question. How big do you think God is? Is God this big? This big? How big? Show me. Show me. How big? Be careful of your neighbor, but show me. How big do you think God is? This big? This big? Even bigger, right? She's got her arms all the way behind her. I don't want to knock the flowers over. Right? God is bigger than maybe we can even imagine. Bigger than we can wrap our arms around. That's how big God's love and mercy and grace is. And we're always growing in new understandings about how big God's love is. Because God's love's always growing too. So today we hear a story where Jesus points us to just how big God's love can be. And thank you for coming up for the children's sermon today. Why don't we close with prayer, okay? All right. Dear Lord.
Dear Lord.
Thank you for your expansive love.
Thank you for your expansive love.
Help us to love.
Help us to love.
In the way of your Son, Jesus Christ.
In the way of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen. We got some choices here today. You want the pencils? Which one do you want? You want that one? There you go. Thank you so much for coming up. Please stand if you are able for the gospel acclamation. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day? When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things he was doing. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Almighty God, we give thanks and praise to be gathered here today on this beautiful summer day. Open our hearts and minds to receive your word, that we may grow in understandings of how expansive our Father's love is for us and all creation. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. This past Tuesday morning, the staff of God's Love gathered for our weekly meeting, where we review the task and discuss all of the ministry tasks for the week. And as is our traditional pattern, our weekly meetings always begin with a brief devotion, centering us in the Word. This week, Pastor Dan led our devotion with a reading from a new book he is enjoying, written by pastor and theologian John Pavlovitz. The book is titled, If God is Love, Don't Be a Jerk. The subtitle is Finding a Faith That Makes Us Better Humans. And I continue to reflect on that throughout the week. In our gospel today, Jesus is halfway through his human journey, feeding, healing, and teaching us his way towards a faith that will make us better humans. We encounter him again in the synagogue teaching on the Sabbath, where a woman in their gathering is stricken by a spirit. Pneuma asthenia, a spirit of weakness. Jesus sees, calls, sets her free with his words. A laying on of hands, her spirit immediately rises and she begins praising God. This healing miracle is as profound as it is concise. And yet, what immediately follows is a voice of rejection. And this is a strange first response to the healing of one of their own congregational members. The recognized leader of this house of worship rises indignantly to reject Jesus' healing work on the Sabbath. Perhaps Jesus' miracle has stolen his Sabbath morning thunder. However, the leader offers a traditional and historically faithful interpretation of the law to support his point of view, citing Moses' words on the third commandment. And as the text notes, other in their gathering agree. Yet Jesus points out this is a narrow interpretation of Sabbath law, and it is not being faithfully applied across all aspects of living for their place and time. The Israelites do not unmercifully ignore the Sabbath needs of their animals, even if this is out of economic necessity. Is not a daughter of Abraham as valuable in God's eyes? The leader is not applying the law equally, nor is his narrow interpretation being adhered to by God's people, rendering not the law, but the interpretation hypocritical. Most simply put, it's as if Jesus is asking, is this a faith that makes us better humans? After our morning devotion last Tuesday, Pastor Dan casually mentioned an excerpt from Pastor Pavlovitz's book he had found particularly funny. It's a story about the author getting trapped in his pants. Now stay with me here. I'm going to get you there, I promise. I was intrigued. It's not something image that leaves one's mind quite easily. So I went out and I found the excerpt online. As the story goes, Pastor Pavlovitz was thumbing through his closet when he found a beloved pair of pants from his youthful 20-something years. He writes this, "As I stared reverently at the glorious acid-washed relic of my youth gone wild, suddenly a A voice in my head that strongly resembled my own said, "You know, I bet they still fit." Like the crafty serpent tempting Adam and Eve in the garden, the voice dared me forward. "Go ahead, try them on." At 51 years old, I still consider myself in pretty good shape, so I answered back with reckless hubris, "Why not?" I was about to get a definitive answer. As one might surmise, this did not end well for Pavlovich. His 1980s skinny jeans were about as narrow as our synagogue leader's interpretation of the law. His beloved pants no longer fit. However, so unable was Pavlovich to resist temptation, he insists on cramming himself into his pants, describing the endeavor as a high-intensity cardio training, hopping violently like a stationary sack race participant in his closet. He professes to a brief, momentary feeling of victory and satisfaction at the conclusion of his workout, until he writes, "I felt the waistband sharply digging into my skin and my legs started to lose feeling quickly to the lack of blood flow." He came to the sobering reality that he was now trapped in his pants. So it is with us. When we hold on to old ways of thinking, when we reverently cling to narrow interpretations of our scriptures, we risk getting trapped by our own reckless hubris into hypocrisy. And like Pavlovich and his pants, our actions will contradict our thinking. Pavlovich writes, "If I had expired there in that closet, my cause of death would have been listed as unintentional spandicide, caused by reckless arrogance. It would have been a classic case of user error. No one would have blamed the pants. They may have functioned back when I bought them, but they certainly weren't designed to contain me 30 years and 4 inches of girth later. I wasn't supposed to fit in them any longer, and I shouldn't have tried." That's how you find yourself in peril in your bedroom closet. That's how we find ourselves in peril in the church. However, unlike Pavlovich and his pants, when we, the church, arrogantly cling to old understandings that do not fit nor function with an expansive mercy and grace for God's people in our place and time, it is not merely a personal dilemma played out in the privacy of our closet, but a communal one that inflicts pain on others entrapped in our narrow thinking, a narrow thinking that can cause us public humiliation. The history of the corporate church in the U.S. across all denominations, including the ELCA, attests to this. Jesus came to set us free from this bondage. Beginning of Luke's gospel, Jesus announced his mission at the synagogue, proclaiming, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." In Luke, Jesus' entire ministry is grounded in Isaiah's message of mercy and grace, which colors his interpretation of Sabbath law. Jesus recalls Moses' final words, "Remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day." Therefore, participating in God's healing, liberating love on the Sabbath is the more expansive expression of the Sabbath's meaning for our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the third time Jesus has healed on the Sabbath, and it hints at what is to come. For Christ's face is set towards the most expansive expression of God's mercy and grace, the cross, which leads to resurrection. Christ loosens all bonds that oppress, including releasing us from a spirit of weakness that cripples our thinking and holds us captive. And when Christ speaks, releasing us from this bondage, the crowds rejoice at the wonderful things he is doing. Last week, Religion News reported on the ELCA's churchwide gathering, its first assembly since the COVID pandemic. The assembly approved a memorial encouraging ELCA members to support creative programs of restorative justice in partnership with Indigenous peoples. This includes land acknowledgments and more. Christ spoke a word of healing, and the crowds rejoiced at the wonderful things he is doing. The assembly approved a memorial authorizing a review of its social statement on human sexuality to make sure that its wording reflects current church understanding, church policy, civil law, and public acceptance of same gender and gender nonconforming couples. Christ spoke a word of healing, and the crowds rejoiced at the wonderful things he is doing. The assembly approved a memorial directing the ELCA Church Council to establish a commission for a renewed Lutheran church, to reconsider the principles of our organizational structure, the statements of purpose for our church's synods, church-wide organization, with particular attention to our shared commitment to dismantle racism. Christ spoke a word of healing, and the crowds rejoiced at the wonderful things he is doing. Christ speaks a word of healing, and we rejoice at the wonderful things he is doing because Christ's love expands our theological understandings into God's expansive mercy and grace. Christ speaks a word of healing, and we rejoice at the wonderful things he is doing because he is leading us towards a faith that will make us better humans. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
together in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, our only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. You crown your church with steadfast love and mercy. Guide us continually in our baptismal covenant to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Use our diverse gifts in service to the whole people of God. Merciful God,
listen to our prayer.
You satisfy the needs of all creatures, repair ecosystems damaged by misuse, neglect, or natural disaster, that all creation may thrive. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You make your ways known to all people. Inspire the rulers and leaders of nations with your compassion and mercy. Raise up God's people to restore places affected by violence, poverty, and inequality. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You provide justice for all who are oppressed and relief to all who are afflicted. Heal those who are bent over by addiction, depression, and anxiety. Set free all who cry out under the weight of mental, emotional, or physical distress. Especially, we pray today for Phil Weber, Sally Wieland, Michelle Young, George Kinsley, Jesse Rogers, Ann Auerwick, Nancy Panapacker, Geraldine Anselmi, Marion Mihalik, David G., Nancy Smooze, Carrie Kanke, Ruth Harrison, Gloria, and those we name aloud or silently at this time. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You call us to delight in the Sabbath. Renew our bodies, minds, and spirits in this worshiping assembly. Give rest to all who lead our congregation in worship, study, and service. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Generations bless your holy name. We give you thanks for the communion of saints. James Wagenvoord and Ernie Steen, who have gathered in prayer and praise in this place. Support us in your love until we rest forever in you. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom.
Amen. The peace of Christ to be with you always. Let us share the peace.
This time we give thanks and praise for all the offerings that flow through our parish, literally on a daily and hourly basis. We give thanks for all the gifts of monetary contributions, in-kind gifts, and gifts of time and talent that are shared many days. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful Father, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray together boldly.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
In Christ's presence there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. We receive you. We invite you to come forward by the center aisle and return by the side aisle this morning. We'll commune the pulpit side first, and then we'll move to the organ side. Those who prefer gluten-free host or grape juice, please indicate that as you come forward.
Gearing up for a wonderful fall filled with opportunities for ministry. One of those is our Sunday school ministry. The team's been working, and I'd like to give special thanks to our new Sunday school superintendent, Rebecca Weatherspoon, who has been working very hard to put together our curriculum for the fall. Information about the Sunday school program, which launches Sunday, September 18th, with our rally day, is available in the messenger and online on our website. The registration packets for all of our Sunday school families that we have in our database went out this week. Special thank you to Kay for getting that all together and out the door. We already got our first response, and the Holy Spirit is afoot, because our very first registration for Sunday school is from a family we haven't seen in a few years, and they're bringing a friend. So that was a really wonderful witness to the work that God is doing through this congregation. The other announcement I would like to make is about a new ministry that we're launching this fall called Teen Thrive. God has been working through our very own Sherry Todd, who is our choir director and organist. She brought this idea last spring to Pastor Dan, and she had identified that youth in our communities are struggling to figure out how to manage stress and anxiety, particularly after COVID and the impact it had on their lack of school connectivity. The program has, we've been working, we ran a pilot program in the spring for 5 weeks that was very well received. And we have a wonderful team of people, Linda Sartor, Robin Kukut, Carrie Cummins, and Amy Kuiper-Shaw, who have come on board. The program is actually being developed by Sherry with some support from me. It's founded in a program that I taught a few years ago as a mental health chaplain. So we're really excited and we're looking forward. We would encourage all your prayers. And if you have would like to get more information on that, to read a little bit more about the spiritual concepts we'll be introducing, like forgiveness and gratitude and radical acceptance, you can check that information out both in the messenger as well as online on our website. And we encourage people to please, if you don't have young people in your home, but you know of young people in their community or places that we can actually get the information out about this opportunity, we would be very grateful. Again, the Holy Spirit is afoot, because I sent a bunch of emails out, one to our Lobux partners in ministry, and we already received a response last night from a congregational member from Ascension who felt that this would be really helpful for their child. So we continue to get the word out there about what God is doing through God's love here. Last but not least, I thought there was one more announcement. Does anybody have any announcements? Yes, thank you, Sandy.
Good morning. I have two announcements. One is our Hope Laundry Ministry is thriving. We started off with just two people of the homeless community coming down to wash their clothes, and now we're up to about 7 or 8 a week. So one of the challenges the homeless face is to be able to bring their laundry from where they live to the laundromat, which is about maybe a mile. AHTN is going to provide transportation, but the problem lies is that we need more volunteers. We need people to come to the laundry and just socialize. So they bring their things, they do their own laundry, you provide them with the soap and the dryer sheets and swipe the credit card, and have some socialization with people while they are doing their laundry. And it's really, really, I don't know, to me it feels like being at Cheers. Hey, how you doing? What's going on? So, and either myself or Emmanuel will be there with you. So if you are interested in that, helping with that, we're running through the pilot program through September. So at the end of the September, we'll decide if we want to continue this or not. So if you want to help, there are openings through September. So let me know. Also, my second announcement is the play David at Sight and Sound Theater in Lancaster. If you've never been to a Sight and Sound production, it is great. It will rival any Broadway play you've ever seen. So there are 2 more weeks to sign up and pay for David, and you'll be getting your tickets. We'll all meet there, and we'll go to lunch afterwards if you want. All right, I will be in the back afterwards to help you sign up for those 2 things.
Thank you, Sandy. And the announcement that I forgot actually is about my ordination, surprisingly, which is coming up September 17th. If you are in town, I would love to see you there. I'd be very grateful to see all of your faces. There will be more information about the specifics of the fellowship, so just look for that in the messenger in the weeks to come. Please rise for the blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen.
We were the beggars,
now we're royalty,
we were the prisoners.